Space, the final frontier. These are the voyages of the starship Cinema Royale. Its mission? To explore the geeky debate of ultimate proportion between Star Trek and Star Wars, where no man, no one has gone before in podcast format.
There can be only one.
I have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass. I'm all out of bubblegum.
Go ahead. Make my day.
Cinema Royale.
Captain's Log. Stardate. 11:30.4. I am your captain, Mike, to introduce this podcast. Welcome to Cinema Royale, guys. This episode's gonna be a little special for you guys. Let me introduce the esteemed panel here who's gonna debate with us. First up, we got Matt Brunales, and I was Anime.
Hey guys! I just came back from vacation, so my mind is all fresh and ready for this battle.
Next up, we got James Sullivan, also known as Homitude.
Tonight's broadcast is brought to you by an inverted cross lightsaber. Kool-Aid colored.
Yummy.
What does he taste like?
Kool-Aid, of course. Duh. Last but not least, Jada.
Jada of 9 for these purposes. Because I couldn't. Here's part of the feminine this newly declammed podcast. I got a lot of hmms. Did nobody get the of 9 thing?
I got the of 9. 7 of 9.
I got the.
Alright.
I got it.
I got it.
I know, because you're a niner. You love Deep Space Nine, I know.
Even though Seven of Nine was not Deep Space Nine. But that's fun.
Oh crap, it was Voyager. Fuck.
Yeah, see, I could have told you that. I didn't watch Voyager that much.
I don't know my Star. I only seen. Wait, just let me.
I've seen every show except Enterprise. Mm-hmm. Has anybody here seen Enterprise?
You see, we already got a problem with Star Trek. It's already confusing with all the different shows. We don't know which one is which.
Seen Enterprise, okay? We can just ignore that a little.
Let me...
Enterprise, that's the one with Kevin Sorbo?
Yeah, I know.
It's the prequel.
The Leap guy.
It's the prequel to the original series.
Oh, okay.
That's what I know.
You know what? Prequels just suck. That is going to be the overarching message of this debate. Prequels?
Yes.
Suck. Right? No arguments?
Right. We'll get into that more. So, Sci-Fi Month ends with this big battle of geeky proportions. This is the biggest, like, ultimate geek battle debate I have ever heard. Like, geeks all over the place, you know, the Star Wars fans, the Trekkies, are like, which is better, Star Trek or Star Wars, for crying out loud? And we're here to discuss all about it. So, just off the bat, let's figure out which side we're on. So, I think I've told only a couple of people, are all of us, who we are side with. So James is the neutral. He's in the middle, literally in the middle.
As you can tell from his apathetic texting.
Literally in the middle, not giving a crap, just texting and literally listening to his music.
Actually, I'm playing Spider-Man Unlimited on my cell phone. I also have a Star Wars game on here. You guys want to hear about it?
Yes.
No.
God. He's on Team Star Wars! He has a game of it!
It was free. That's why I got it. And it's good.
See, that's a good debate about Star Wars. They give you things for free.
Games cost money.
Yeah, you need to pay for the good games. Not the free, crappy ones.
Yeah.
And, as you can tell, Matt is the obvious Star Wars fan out of the group.
Well, I just want to mention that I have to represent Star Wars because One of my cousins from my family, he is such a huge, huge, huge Star Wars fan, and it has eventually grown upon the entire family. So, like, it's all because of him. We know a lot of things about Star Wars from the movies to what happens in the scenes and all that scenarios.
It's infectious.
About the mouse.
Oh yeah, definitely.
From the right with judgment right there. He's watching.
Who? Wait, who? What?
Oh,
right,
yeah, Mickey Mouse.
Oh,
he's right here.
The mouse. The mouse is watching.
Oh, this one?
Yeah, that
better
one.
I actually have. I thought you were referring to this one.
Huh.
Like, he has this glare.
I'm
that's
everywhere.
Like...
Oh my god, he's hitting me.
Hey, it's a
nice.
Birthday for my friend, so, like. I thought you were referring to this one. Check. This is a face of Mickey Mouse always watching you.
Well,
and that is what owns Star Wars, so therefore, haha.
Disney's on your side, oh my god.
Oh yeah, and also it's a Disney property now.
Yes, that was my joke from the get-go.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, I'm just laughing too hard. And yes, Jade and I are the Star Trek fans representing Star Trek. I guess we can... I actually want to go deeper down into our souls. Like, how do we get introduced into these two franchises? Like, I know we have our differences, so... I know Matt discussed about his discovery of Star Wars.
Like, my reasoning to how I ended up here.
Yep. So, who wants to actually... talk about how they got into the franchises.
Well,
I guess I can start with my story. It's a little bit different, probably from some of you guys. I put the phone down. I'm being serious.
She actually called dibs first.
Oh, she did?
No, that's fine. Come on, go. Doesn't matter.
Okay, if you're going to be like this... Are you going to be like this throughout the whole podcast? Just turn your back?
This is actually going to be easier than I thought.
I'll turn my back periodically so that I can turn back around dramatically. Like this.
Oh, yeah.
If this were cordless, I would do the same thing, except I would just spin around like an idiot.
Whee!
Yeah.
Okay, James, you can go first.
Okay. As a wee little Jaime-tude, we did have copies of some of the Star Wars movies on tape from, you know, during the time my folks recorded off of television. But I never actually got into it when I was a really little kid. You know, a lot of it just sort of flew over my head. My enthusiasm didn't hit until I was about 11 or so. And I discovered the Star Wars games. And what a difference it makes approaching the franchise from that perspective on a whole new level of engagement. And so I was in middle school, and I think my enthusiasm started the moment I took the game Star Wars Rebel Assault and popped it into my computer for the first time. As soon as the first level comes in, it was a training level. You have to learn to fly with a joystick, but as soon as the music and the game graphics hit, it was on. I was in from that moment, and there was a huge streak going through there. I ended up getting even the special edition when that came out on tape, and a complete guide to the Star Wars universe as of the 90s, you know, the pre-Phantom Menace period. And as far as Star Trek, mainly my introduction for that was I would watch that during the summertime when I was visiting my grandmother in Louisiana. And there was one summer where we sat down and we watched nothing but reruns of the original series, and had a pretty good time with that. It came time eventually to start watching some of the films. It's been a while since I've seen them. I went through those at a pretty young age, and then from there on, I was experimenting with the different series that they had: Deep Space Nine, Next Generation, Voyager. If a neighbor had a copy of it on tape and I could borrow it, I was good. So that's my story, and I'm sticking to it.
That's a country music song. That's my story, and I'm sticking to it. My mom listened to a lot of country music.
So,
anyways, Jada, would you like to go next?
May I? Okay. Well, I've been exposed to both Star Trek and Star Wars from pretty much my whole life. My mom and dad are huge fans of them both. My uncle, Darren, is actually a really, really hardcore Star Wars fan. He's one of those guys, he has like a crap ton of merchandise, like every kind of thing you can think of. We used to have a cupboard in our den that was like full of these, like, there were McDonald's cups, Jar Jar Binks on them. There was like Rubik's cubes and statues and action figures, all sorts of shit. Anyway, so from when I was a kid, the most I saw of Star Trek was mainly Next Generation and Voyager, which aired on Space back to back and still does, and which we would watch periodically, and I liked it. But as a kid, I actually didn't like Star Trek as much as Star Wars. I liked Star Wars a lot more as a kid. It was when I got older, and two things happened. The first was I started to look at the Star Wars movies with a different perspective, specifically the Star Wars prequels. Like, because as a kid, I grew up on all the Star Wars movies, and I liked them all. But as I got older, I started to see more of the flaws in, like, the prequels and stuff, and it kind of, because I was always exposed to the franchise as a whole, it's kind of soured the entirety of the franchise for me. Not to the point where I can't see the value in each movie, even in the prequels to some extent, but it's like it changed things, you know. And the other thing that happened was my dad got for his one of the Star Trek movies. I had seen none of them at the time, so I watched all of them, including the bad ones, which you know I could tell were bad. But I also saw the good ones. I saw Wrath of Khan and The Voyage Home and 6. Which I keep forgetting the actual name of 6.
Undiscovered Country.
Undiscovered Country, thank you. And I became a much bigger fan of Star Trek. I became a fan of Captain Kirk, and later on I became a fan of Captain Sisko when I watched Deep Space Nine on recommendation of my dad, and that became my favorite Star Trek show. I realized that there was a lot more of Star Trek, and I there was more to get into, and more that wasn't soured by aging and jadedness of nostalgia, because it was newer.
It's an older franchise that was newer.
Yeah.
I guess.
Perspective's a funny thing.
Wait. What?
Abigail?
I am speaking English. I feel like I keep confusing my fellow podcasters.
What? But you're mixing up.
Star Trek is newer, but like it was released before, I think a decade before Star Wars.
At least a decade.
Now hold on a minute. What I meant was that Star Wars was older than me, and that I saw it first.
So everything from there on was new to you.
Yeah, it was new to me. Not newer, but new to me.
Yep.
And that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. That's the country.
So, a young 19-year-old me discovered J.J. Abrams' Star Trek film. Saw it, kind of dug the hell of it, was curious about it, and I went to watch the original series as much as I can. I don't remember much of it, that's why last week I actually binge-watched Star Trek. Eventually, I did see the films, getting at the local library and checking them out, each by each, even the bad ones, like Jada said. There's this, like, thing going around where the odd ones are the bad ones. I will say that my watching of it was a little bit different than everybody else's. There's an episode of Star Trek called Space Seed, and that's the first introduction of Khan. That's a perfect segue into Star Trek II, The Wrath of Khan. I was like, it's a direct sequel to the episode, and I was like, okay, fuck the motion picture, I'll just watch that instead. And The Wrath of Khan is actually probably one of my favorite, because Khan is like a total badass compared to, you know, like Darth Vader or Darth Maul, because there's a reason behind his disliking for Kirk, because they have a big history between each other. 3 isn't so bad, even though people say it's really bad, but it's not. It's 2, 3, and 4 are actually a one long arc. You have to watch to see to know, but it kind of, at the beginning of the films, they kind of tell you what happens. 5 is really bad. William Shatner just shat on the 5th film.
Is that the one where they row the boat? Where they were on
the
a campfire?
They sing
and
about rowing a boat.
Yeah, that's where they're singing about rowing the
boat. I don't think they actually ever at any point row a boat.
No, that's what I meant. Like, they just, at a campfire and just sing, row, row, row your boat.
You know, I kind of liked that scene. I kind of liked Spock's reaction. Like, you sing when you have a good time. Were we having a good time?
Row your boat, row, row, row your boat, gently down the street.
It was just one of the weird moments. It's just like, but... Yeah, and then 6, the 4 is actually really good, actually. Actually, I did like 4 a lot more, because they actually went back in time to the 80s, and I was like, oh, this is great. This is going to be a little culture shock, and it's hilarious seeing him react to the 80s and shit, and fucking A. I love that. And then 6, Undiscovered Country, is actually a really good one as well. So... it's all thanks to J.J. Abrams, pretty much, in my opinion. It was for my story.
How delightfully ironic.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, how weird that was for me, but now I'm a Star Trek fan. I mean, Star Trek for me was just like following the voyage of the original series. I have not seen Next Generation, Voyager, Deep Space Nine, Enterprise.
Have you seen any of the Next Gen movies?
I have not jumped into the Next Gen movies because I kind of want to see the Next Gen series along with it too, so I kind of understand the characters and stuff. Generations, however, they kind of have both the Next Generation and the original cast is kind of a stinker as well.
Mostly Picard, though. Like, there's a couple. There's Kirk and there's Chekhov. Yeah. I show up in, like, one scene at the beginning, but that's about it.
But they killed.
See, the only Star Trek movie that I have not seen is the first one. But I never got onto this whole thing about, the odd movies suck, but the even ones are awesome, you know? I always just sort of looked at them and said, okay.
Yeah, for me, I completely ignored that. I just went from the original series, 2, 3, 4, skipped 5, and then 6, pretty
it's
much.
Not 100%.
Yeah, who wrote that rule?
It's not 100% true either, because the odd movies, they had Search for Spock, which was good. And the even movies, they had Nemesis, which was...
Actually, I lied. That was the one that I have not seen, Nemesis.
Nemesis? Good.
Mm-hmm.
Good.
But then Star Wars is a completely different story. It's like, I guess I grew up as a kid, you know, my dad used to, I guess my dad introduced it to me, we were watching it once, and, you know, the concept I thought was really good, and then, you know, but when the prequels came out, I wasn't really interested, because I was like 9 years old at the time when the prequels came out, so I just didn't get into it more. These two franchises are different in so many ways, but they have Star in the title. I guess I kind of compared each franchise. Star Trek is like a Western in space. They explore space like how the Westerns do with the kettles and Organine Trail and all that shit. Which is great, because that's what I liked about it, the adventure of it, exploring stuff. Star Wars kind of has the sci-fi and then a little bit of fantasy mm-hmm. into it, where it's the swords and, you know, the knights.
Well, one of the big differences about Star Trek and Star Wars is that Star Trek is about the journey. Like, you follow the adventures of the captain, well, whoever it is, depending on what you're watching, and, like, yep. the crew go on these adventures. Where Star Wars, on the other hand, is more about the worlds. Like, this is about the galaxies and the different worlds, how they live and what they do, what are the Jedi Knights, and all that stuff. So, like, they both have different, like, they both set out different goals and, like, different fixtures on what makes their franchise is very unique in a way.
Yeah.
Actually, I'd argue Star Wars is also a little bit like a Western. In fact, yeah. some key moments in there were modeled after a particular Western or driven
Oh, no, that is true. Like, there are several Westerns, it was based on.
Yeah,
there's key scenes from The Searchers with John Wayne that are later mimicked in Star Wars, the way that everything is paced out.
George Lucas seems to, you know, took a lot of stuff from the past and just, like, stuck it into this mm-hmm. film. And I heard that he made Star Wars possible because he originally wanted to do a Flash Gordon movie, but the rights were taken up, lickety-split, and he's like, okay, I better write this sci-fi epic of Star Wars.
Maybe I gotta replace all the names and stuff like that, and, you know, instead of Flash Gordon, I'll just, you know, hold on, let me pick the names out of my head. Star, okay, Wars.
George Lucas in a while.
It's, let's see, I'm going to call my movies.
It's so, alright, what are the advantages of both franchises? Mm-hmm. Matt, what are the advantages of Star Wars?
Well, for Star Wars, it's mostly about, the biggest focus is about the movies. Like, the biggest thing where Star Trek usually, where they would focus more on establishing everything through their television series, Star Wars is about the films. Like, they try to, like, they, each of them have this major, big budget adventure. And it really, like, it looks fascinating. And like I said before, like, they really do set up this entire universe to the point where it's like it's practically its own, like, it pretty much establishes, like, everything about it, and that it has become this big culture, like, where everybody, like, pretty much everybody wants to be in, because this is pretty much a world unlike anything other, because, like, it's like it has a lot of the different, like, space elements, and it has, like, you know, the aliens and stuff like that. But funny enough, like, you actually mentioned that this is also part fantasy, because, like, there is a bit of that fantasy element where it does function like a fantasy film, where like it is about the world that you're in, where pretty much like, sure, we follow the adventures of Luke Skywalker and all that stuff, but like we learn a lot about being a Jedi and how like and how droids work and like how like what kind of spaceships they use in order to function, the monarchy and all that stuff. They pretty much established this world. Well, it's pretty much like I said, they established this entire world that can live entirely in its own civilization. That's pretty much believable, you know. Like, I'm not saying it's like realistic and stuff like that, but if you would live in a world like that, it would definitely function, because this is how things work. There is a bit of a sense of that of believability, but because of the fictional aspects from the characters, like all the different races and species and aliens all living together, and pretty much they all share in common like sports or like entertainment and all that stuff, and sometimes like down and dirty things happen, like, you know, like the Imperial Army or the Mafia with Jabba the Hutt. Like, it's pretty much its own world. It has its own problems, and it has its own stuff. So, that would be one of the biggest things that makes Star Wars so big, is that it pretty much establishes its own universe, where it's pretty much what it's all about.
Yeah, I sort of see your point with the films and whatnot. You can technically... if you're examining the Star Wars universe, they have, yes, they have this six so far films that were made and re-edited and re-released and what have you, but everything else that relates to the franchise is optional. Like, you could get a entire grip of what the world of Star Wars is about just by watching the films, and not have to watch Clone Wars on TV, or if you were a big fan back in the 80s watching either the droids or the Ewoks cartoons, or getting into the getting into the video games, for that matter. You don't have to know who Kyle Katarn is. Can anyone else besides Matt tell me who Kyle Katarn is? Okay. Kyle Katarn was a fan favorite from the Star Wars games. He was a reoccurring character in there, sort of a bounty hunter gone Jedi.
He must be either like a pod racer or a bounty hunter. Like, I had that feeling.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, see? But his entire story is optional to explore.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he's friends with Han Solo and whatnot, but he's not in the film, so he's just somebody else that Han seems to know off camera.
Yeah, because that's the thing. It's like, it's kind of optional to buy the fact that, like, if you got the idea that it feels like such a believable world, then you got it. But like, the more you get into it, like, the more convincing it is. Like, you don't have to know about Cal Katarn or other people, but they do. Like, each and every single character in there, they have such a backstory into it, where, like, you know, they can be like believable people in this world. Like, when you go into if you go into the Star Wars universe and meet them, it's like, you would know, like, you would feel like they do exist in this world.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
It's an interesting question I kind of wanted to bring. Has anybody seen Star Wars Rebels?
The show?
Yeah.
Meh.
It's a new show.
The new show Star Wars Rebels, no. I haven't seen it.
I've heard of it.
It's okay. I'm not fond of some of the dialogue, and the characters are kind of your typical characters for like a ragtag bunch of misfits. But it's not bad. It's got good stories, a good premise. I recommend it if you're a fan of the Clone Wars. It's very similar to the Clone Wars in a lot of ways. It's got similar animation.
Mm. Is it like a spinoff? I guess
it's basically what happens between Revenge of the Sith and A New Hope.
There seems to be a lot of things that has happened at this point. Like, they do so many things. Like, I've heard of so many things that they do in between for between Revenge of the Sith and A New Hope. Like, not only the the Rebels, but also the Force Awakening games, if you guys remember. Like, I don't know, they're like recent Star Wars games where you play as Darth Vader's, not assistant, but like...
Wasn't it like a clone you're talking about? I know what game you're talking about. I know somebody talked about it in a video somewhere. I know what game you're talking about.
I think like a Padawan, like... Vader's Padawan or something, you know.
Something like that. The
Force Unleashed?
Yes, The Force Unleashed, yeah.
That's the one I was thinking of, yeah.
What did I say? Force the Force Unleashed. Awakening? Sorry.
Yeah, Force Awakening. That's the new...
Whoops, sorry, no. The Force Unleashed, sorry.
Unleashed. Looking into Awakening.
No, but you know what I mean. Like, they really do seem to have a lot of things happen in between, and that's the thing, is like, and that's another factor, yeah. Like, they add in so many things, because like, it's still believable that they're like, they can happen like, all at the same time, like, while the events of The Force Unleashed happens, oh look, a game, there's also, while The Force Unleashed happens, you also have Star Wars Rebels happening. So, like, there is a bit of sense, that's the bit of the sense where, like, the reality of the world has its mark in there. Because, like, much things happen in the universe.
Yeah, there's that gap between the prequels and that original trilogy, and they fill so much stuff in there, like, let's bridge it together, it's just... Just like, okay, I see you want to expand the universe, that's fine, that's just...
But, like, they just, pretty much, like, at this point, they pretty much expanded to like, the size of the universe. Because if you're going to count, not just, like, the movies themselves, at this point, they're pretty much the basic of, like, the entire universe of the Star Wars. Like, now you have, like, the TV shows, you also got the... the TV shows, you got the video games, you got the novels, you got the comics, you got like all these different things. Like Star Wars has basically they've pretty much established themselves in every form of entertainment medium.
Yeah, and they're essentially pretty much a brand. Star Wars is a brand pretty much. It's everywhere. It's like the most, and I will say that Star Wars is more popular than Star Trek. Pretty much, I would think.
Boom.
About that, I'd say.
Let me. I've done searches. I've typed in Star Wars versus Star Trek, and the results were bigger than each other, and there, especially when it comes to like, you know, parodies on YouTube. There's like, it's Star Wars has a huge fan base, and it's a brand because it's everywhere. Star Trek. It's very subtle. I mean, Star Trek has...
Star Trek is a franchise. Star Wars is a brand. Is what you're going
well,
at.
Well, I don't...
I
can't measure quality by popularity anyway.
That's what most people do.
Well...
They do measure by popularity, which I'm I don't want to do. I'm just saying people have said that to me, like, oh, Star Wars is so much popular than Star Trek. Oh, my gosh. I'm like, no. It's like, I don't care. They're both equal in my opinion, you dumbass. So,
well, I mean, it is true that popularity doesn't usually mean good. I mean, The Room is getting quite popular, you know. But is it a good movie?
Exactly.
When you think about popularity, Twilight probably has the bigger staple in vampire lore than True Blood. Or even Vampire Diaries, which I haven't seen, but I'll wager it's better than Twilight.
Yeah, hey, popularity.
Give me Bela Lugosi anytime. Thank you very much.
It's got to pull the Twilight card with popularity as quality comes up.
Yeah. But with
you get what I mean. Like, it's actually because of this popularity, though, that they pretty much made themselves so big. You know.
Exactly. Yeah.
Because like now at this point, I heard apparently in New Zealand. A Jedi can actually be considered a real religion.
Yeah, it's that big. I mean, Star Wars has tried to establish themselves in TV for quite some time over the years. I believe I read there was like 40 ideas, like 40 unproduced shows that got canned for some reason.
I think one of them was with. I think one of the recent ones that I've heard was from Seth Green, I believe.
The Detours? Yeah, Star Wars Detours or something.
Like a sick of sorts.
Yeah, I never heard anything from it. But yeah, while Star Trek is based in television, they have succeeded, well, sort of. The original series kind of got canned after 3 seasons, but the popularity of the show actually expanded more into, you know, branching out to films, and then eventually, you know, hey, we'll start a new series called The Next Generation, and then that's where everything bloomed with Star Trek. You know, it moved on with another show, another show, another show, but with movies, it kind of went from original series, Next Generation, and then until the reboot.
Quite frankly, Next Generation didn't have they had one really good movie, and the rest of them didn't do very well. They were gonna make a Deep Space Nine movie.
Yeah, you're overlooking.
And I'm so disappointed that they.
Well, Mike, you're also overlooking Voyager.
Voyager also never had a movie.
It never had a movie, but it wasn't a bad show.
No, I'm not dissing the shows. I'm saying that Star Trek has its focus in television, while Star Wars has its focus in films.
Mm-hmm. Like Star Trek. Like I said before, Star Trek is made more as a, Star Trek was made more as a TV show because it's all about the journey, because, like, of the situations they would get into, while Star Wars is one big adventure, because, like, you got this one big goal, and it's to stop the Darth Vader, Emperor Palpatine, and the Imperial Army.
And yet, I've got to
one solid good versus evil goal.
There are more Star Trek movies than Star Wars movies. Because Star Trek is technically the larger franchise in terms of content.
Yeah.
Well, technically, but like with TV shows, like you can definitely make more, like depending, like because like you can have, because it like. Of the stuff that happens, like you could definitely make more movies. Case in point, Pokemon.
It's not always the case, though. Like particularly with science fiction movies. Like, were there any Galactica movies?
I think so.
Maybe on
during
TV.
The original run, there was probably one that was released that was the pilot or something.
Well,
but
that doesn't count. I mean, movie.
Battlestar Galactica didn't have a series of movies until later on, until the reboot of Battlestar Galactica started doing these mini-series and then doing these little TV movies and then doing their own series.
Well, that's not... I guess that's not quite on the same level as, like, theatrically released movies, which...
I know Stargate
had the movie that came out before the show, but no movies after the show. Probably because of the movie that came out before the show.
Yeah, Stargate, I never got into that, really. Not even the film.
Yeah.
With the advantages of Star Trek is that there's more... There is more. Like, you can get into all the adventures, depending on which crew you go with, whether it's the original, the next gen, the Voyager, the Deep Space Nine, or the prequel known as Enterprise, but that might be the disadvantage of both franchises as the prequels.
Hmm.
Well.
Well, at least Star Wars didn't go into darkness with its prequels. I had to go there.
arguably, you could say they did, but I really never complained with the Star Wars prequels. With Star Trek, Into Darkness, I was just looking at that and saying, "Oh my goodness, it has nothing new to bring to the table." It was a popcorn flick, all right, and I liked the first one out of the two, but
here's the thing: Star Trek has more bad movies than Star Wars. Even if you take into account the holiday special, which I don't think should come into play here, I don't think that should count.
Is it too much of a low blow, that holiday special?
Even taking that into account, there are more bad Star Trek movies than there are bad Star Wars movies, specifically because there are more Star Trek movies than Star Wars movies. Quite frankly, most Star Trek movies, including the bad ones, I would probably take over any of the Star Wars prequels. Like, I would argue maybe 5, and maybe 1, because 1 was boring. But all the other ones, it's honestly, I'd probably take them over the prequels.
Yeah.
On most occasions. Yeah. That includes Insurrection, Generations, Nemesis, and Into Darkness.
Well, the one thing I will say about the prequels is that, like, I understand, yeah, they can be pretty bad, but it's not for what it is. It's not from the writing or stuff like that. It's mostly through execution. I mean, like, no, I can understand, like, where where it's going, because, like, it's trying to establish how things all began, because this is where, like, the characters we all know and love started. This is how Anakin Skywalker has become, like, Darth Vader. We see his origins and all that stuff. But it's mostly the things that happen in it that gets a little screwed up. That little kid cannot act for Jack. And then we also got another problem. Like, Star Wars has another problem because of the existence of Jar Jar Binks. That had to be, like, for some reason, that had to be a thing. Like, I'll admit, there are things that did wrong.
I don't mind Jar Jar.
The problems with the prequels are a lot more fundamental than just singular aspects, like Jake Lloyd and Jar Jar. Those are singular aspects that were annoying. But when you talk about, like, fundamental problems with, like, the movies as a whole, like the writing of the dialogue and the handling of the Jedi Council and the political stuff, the massive overuse of CGI and green screens and that kind of stuff. Those are the things that to me brought the prequels down more than, like, singular things like Jar Jar Binks and Padme.
Well, I
you didn't like Padme?
CG had to be.
No. Mostly the dialogue's fault, though, because her dialogue was so inane.
Well, yeah, again, it's not, the ideas are there, it's just the execution is just pretty bad, but like the CGI, I mean, come on, like, we're living in, like, it's growing into a new age, so it's like it's kind of expected. Like, they can't just go
it's
back
not
into
so much CGI. It's that the CGI wasn't very good, and that it stood out a lot. Like, you could tell all the time that they were behind green screens, all the time.
I don't know. By the time they got to the second film. By the time they got to the second film, I thought it was pretty seamless.
Yeah. They're pretty good.
I wasn't
good.
Complaining there.
But the one thing I want to say is Episode 3, I need to say that I honestly do feel like it's getting a bad rep. It's actually I think it's actually pretty good. I'm not saying it's the best of the Star Wars films, but I think they did a good job with it. Like, because, like whatever they did good, like, they really did good. It really is impressive. And whenever the stupid things happen, I actually kind of like them. Because there's that dumb... It's like... The best way to describe them is, like, those scenes are stupid, but it's, like, enjoyably stupid. Like, they're really campy. It's like you get a bit of that cheesiness from the Sam Raimi Spider-Man films. And, like, overall, it's, like, you get something that's not perfect, but it's still pretty enjoyable.
I beg to say this much about the third film in the series. When that was out and that was fresh in the theaters, I still remember the big consensus with that was Anakin's transformation as a character. They hinted at before in this series that he had this darkness streak to him, but it was more like a teenage rebel. And
exactly.
So to watch him go rather abruptly from being this slightly rebellious teenager to all of a sudden I wanna be a Sith Lord.
I wanna kill kids.
Yes, exactly. He's like, where did his... Okay, so he's in love with Padme, but where is his conscience in all this? Where is his...
Well, you know, I didn't think the change was all that abrupt, but mostly I think that's because he never really, to me, displayed all that much empathy. Like, he always struck me as kind of selfish and, like, out for power. Kind of, he whined a lot. He did the thing with the sand people, and he didn't really seem to care about what he did beyond the one moment where he was just like, I killed many people. And Padme was like, that's okay, you were just mad. I don't like
we all get those moments, dear.
To be angry is to be human. Actual dialogue.
Oh, yeah.
Anyway.
I blame that on the actor more than, like, the script and stuff like that, honestly.
I blame both.
Yeah.
Both.
You can say that, yeah. Sometimes the script can be really bad, and sometimes the person acting it could have a really bad effect to it as well.
Because, I'm sure, if you think of those same scenes with another actor who could do a much better job, I'm sure, like, it would definitely improve it.
It might improve it, but I'm not sure how much empathy you can put into, well, I should be. And someday I'm going to be more powerful than all the Jedi. Or lines like, I don't like sand.
Yeah,
I don't like sand. I grew up around sand, but I don't like sand. There's only so much you can do. Like, even Christopher Lee was having trouble with some of that dialogue. And that's Christopher Lee. You know?
Well, Christopher Lee is, like, one of the better parts, you know?
Yeah, even though he had the stupidest name.
Dooku.
Yeah,
Dooku.
Count Dooku.
What's wrong with Dooku?
What'd you do, cute little Dooku? Yes, you are. Cute little Dooku.
Dooku. Dooku.
So, fearsome count. Dooku.
Bow.
So what's...
Dooku.
Alright, so let me ask this
I
again.
I'm not here to be poked fun at, you know.
Alright, James and Matt, what is the best Star Wars film? In your opinion.
No, but like I said, I'd probably go with either 5 or 6 with Empire Strikes Back or Return of the Jedi. James?
I'm going to go with the... in the moment, in the heat of the moment, I'm going to go with the Return of the Jedi.
The thing is that I noticed is that George Lucas has directed only, four out of 6 of the films. He didn't direct Empire Strike Back or Return of the Jedi.
Because he was busy with other projects as well.
Yeah, I think, like, wasn't he also starting to make Indiana Jones during that time? Or
Indiana Jones and other things. Land of Probably. Howard the Duck.
You know. Oh, God.
Oh, that's right, yeah. Well, wait, no, it was probably after.
Sorry,
love for Howard the Duck?
Sorry, I can't do Return of Jedi. Can you go direct it? I gotta put some boots on to Stuck now.
Totally made the right decision. And Willow was in the 80s. Maybe Willow was around Empire time. I'm not sure. You remember Willow, don't you?
Yeah, Willow.
Oh, yeah, Willow, yeah.
Yeah,
Willow's
in
the
era.
Willow's
okay. Wasn't Willow?
So,
So,
is George Lucas, like for Emperor Strikes Back and Return of the Jedi, is it good to have him not direct the films? Or is it, like, the prequels are all directed by George Lucas? Is he the problem with the scripts and the directing?
No. I wouldn't say he's the problem with the scripts. I mean, he is. He is also the writer of all of them.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, it does come from his brain. So, I wouldn't say he totally is the problem.
I think he's part of the problem, but definitely not all of the problem. I think Hollywood executives and certain demands made, and yes, some of the actors, I think everyone deserves a little slice of the pie there. Shouldn't be all like
Lucas. He is... Lucas is kind of like Spielberg in a way when it comes to producing. There's a certain level... the difference between a director and a producer is a director... the director says, this is how it gets made, and the producer says, this is what gets made. If that makes sense.
Mm.
Yeah.
So, but director producers like Lucas and Spielberg, over time they sort of blend the boundaries of what makes the direction and the production. It's kind of like how when Tim Burton hired Henry Selick for Nightmare Before Christmas, he hired him on there because he could execute his vision for that particular project. Mm-hmm. Well, it's the same case with Spielberg and Lucas. So I'm not gonna say that he was completely discarded from 5 and 6. I just think that those were the type. In my case, I think with 6, it was just more of the type of story that I liked. We got to see Luke come full circle in his character. He starts out in the first film as this slightly childish young man with playing with a toy model in his room. Not just being an adult, but a completely badass adult.
Mm-hmm.
In the third film.
The man who what he always wanted to be, pretty much.
Yeah, not the man that he always wanted to be, per se, but the man that he eventually becomes, which are two different things. I'm sure he didn't... Yeah, he wanted, from the get-go, to be an adventurer, but when you set out to have a goal in life like that, do you sit back and say, the price of this is I lose my uncle and aunt in the process. I form bonds with people that die. I find out that my father is my worst enemy. No. Those were all just things that happened to him. Hmm. So, he became, Luke becomes the man that, that he is maybe not the one that he wanted to be.
Okay.
I actually wanted to bring up this interesting story about how Mark Hamill got into the role of Luke Skywalker. Mm. And it's all thanks to a man that keeps following me around in each of these episodes of the podcast. The man that I seem to talk about a lot, Robert Englund.
Oh my god. Robert... Him again?
I'm ready for Fred.
Without Robert Englund, Mark Hamill probably would not be Luke Skywalker. So, Robert Englund was going to audition for Star Wars as Han Solo, and people are like, you're too young. So, he was interviewed, and he said this, and then I went home and told a little kid that was sleeping on my couch after a six-pack of Heineken all about Star Wars. His name was Mark Hamill. I said, hey, Lucas is doing the space movie. Maybe you're right for it. Lead this guy's like a teenager, so Mark got on the phone to his agent, and I think he went the next day, and he nailed it, and the rest is history.
So Mark Hamill was passed out on his couch?
Yeah. at Robert Englund's. So without Robert Englund, we wouldn't have that awesome role by Mark Hamill.
You should, you should really get into science.
You were there at the right time, dude.
You should really think about doing science fiction, you know, because I tried it out and I was in B.
He was in B. I remember that.
Huh? Yeah.
I remember that he was in B. Was that ever for Star Wars?
It was a big thing on television, but they never really made any TV show, any theatrical movies. What the heck?
Wasn't my question. My question was it before Star Wars?
No, it was not.
Okay. So he wasn't known for anything at the time.
Probably. Yeah.
He was a new guy.
But the joke was too good to pass up.
So, I've never seen Enterprise. That was supposed to be a prequel to the original series, but the prequel / reboot known as Star Trek, which is actually the first and only movie that has a title of Star Trek, is actually an interesting one. It's not only is the reboot a prequel showing how these characters meet up at the Academy, but it's set in an alternate timeline, which is different because it features Leonard Nimoy as Spock. Mm-hmm. As
that, I thought it was back. A cool cameo. That I admit.
That that is a interesting thing.
When Spock came on the scene, I still remember that audience in the theater. As soon as he turned around, looking at the audience, there was like, "Whoa!"
It was. It was the coolest thing about the movie because it does something different than no other prequel film does. Because it acknowledges the past. It doesn't like, "Oh, just start from scratch and just go with it and stuff," but.
Like, it's not rebooting, per se.
It's rebooting, yet it acknowledges the universe of its rebooting of...
And it comes out and explains it's rebooting, too. Which is pretty amazing.
It is. It's pretty interesting. The first film, I mean, I was like, okay, I dig the hell out of you. It's like... Because,
Was...
Go on.
Was I the only one in the group watching the new Star Trek movies and saying, those guys look like they just got out of those Halloween costumes last year?
Oh my god.
I don't mean to be mean, but you look at... Okay, for the majority of it, yeah. Kirk, sure. Bones, yes. Spock, They made him look so much like the Nimoy Spock. It was kind of like, okay, Halloween costume.
Yeah.
It's kind of the whole point, because he's a young Spock, and then Spock is... Actually, he's titled as Spock Prime in the film, but...
Spock... Wait, who's Spock Prime? The new Spock or Leonard Nimoy?
No, Leonard Nimoy.
Spock Prime.
That's kind of interesting trivia, because at the same time, the writer of this film also wrote Transformers.
Oh.
So, and Michael Bay is actually the cousin-in-law of Leonard Nimoy.
Oh, really?
Because Leonard Nimoy is married to Susan Bay, who is a cousin of Michael
Bay.
Oh. So Michael Bay didn't want to ask Leonard Nimoy for a small role in the film, so the writers / producers like, hey, why don't you voice the film in our future? And they kind of paid homage to both Transformers and Star Trek by saying, oh, he's Spock Prime, as like Optimus Prime.
What, like, I don't recall, like, telling, like, he went off to tell past Kurtz, like, now you just go get out there and roll out.
Is that what it was? It was...
Or maybe he's, like, post-credits, like, he's just looking at the Enterprise and he's just there, we did good. Right, Shatner, Bumblebee? No, Bumble Shatner?
You can't bring me back. I'm dead, remember?
You really did good. You know, you really did a good job there, Prime. I'm really proud of you.
Thanks. Where were you when I needed your help?
So, J.J. Abrams was, you know, he's doing his own thing, you know, with this reboot, and it was an interesting mix between, you know, being a reboot / prequel, seeing him as a young age, meeting up for the first time, and then kind of like, oh shit, it's a time traveling thing where the bad guy and the old Spock came into the past, and it's an alternate timeline.
Mm-hmm.
It's just, I like that mix between acknowledging the universe within the reboot. Like, it's not be like, start from fresh, man, and just do the hell we want with it.
And then as soon as they tried doing that again in the second one, it felt like it was old hat. You know, they literally recycled the dialogue and everything.
And, yeah, I kind of agree with you there, because I didn't... When I first saw Into Darkness, I was like, okay, Khan, yeah. Benedict Cumberbatch, yeah, that's cool. Action, yeah, that's cool. After I watched the original movies and watched it again afterwards, I was like, they are rehashing this shit all over again. What the fuck?
Told ya.
It's a funny thing.
It's just, I mean, it's like, why, I mean, I can understand bringing Khan because he's the most recognizable bad guy in the Star Trek universe, I mean, but I would think you could make a better, you know, like, reboot / prequel, like, story to Khan, like...
You could have taken advantage
of... You want to have your audience, like, shake again, you know?
You could have taken advantage in a better way of the fact that Khan didn't know who Kirk was and didn't have the whole revenge thing going on, you know?
Exactly, because Kirk wasn't the one that, unfroze Khan in the beginning with. It was, the Admiral. It was like, wait, that has nothing to do with Kirk at all.
But they didn't. It had to be that he really wanted to get at Kirk, because that's what's recognizable, so they twisted it around, so eventually it ended up being exactly where they were, only different.
Didn't they reenact that scene into Darkness?
Yeah. They did the whole thing from Wrath of Khan. They had to do this.
Like the whole monologue, and then you see Shatner, but I mean, you see Kirk shaking.
No.
Khan!
It was.
But it's flipped. It's flipped around.
Mm-hmm.
Kirk does what Spock does instead, and then Spock says, Khan!
Yep. Because it happened the other way around, now it's fresh, right?
Nope.
No, that doesn't make sense.
It's the ultimate timeline, so they just like, wait, Kirk didn't do this. Wait, Spock didn't do that. It's vice versa now. I didn't like Into the Darkness. I kind of like the first one. That's why I had the first one on DVD to begin with. So I didn't buy the second one. So there's some disadvantages when it comes to Star Trek. I mean, the old films, new films, you know.
Mm-hmm. Something like that. Old films, new films.
So this is going to get a little interesting. Now, let me talk about the new Star Wars film coming out next year. So I said J.J.'s did the first two Star Trek films. Well, apparently he's directing Episode 7 of Star Wars.
It doesn't matter if he screwed up Into Darkness, he is still money.
Yep.
I mean, J.J. is a good actor. Director.
Probably a terrible actor.
God, I could love to see him act. He's a great director. I've seen his films. It's pretty good. I mean, Star Trek, Super 8, and Cloverfield wasn't so bad.
I enjoyed Cloverfield. I jumped back in my seat quite a lot there.
It was good.
He does good things. I mean, like, people do love Bad Robot. Is it Bad Robot?
Yes, it's Bad Robot.
People love that Bad Robot, so...
Yeah, that's good stuff, but this is the first time in geek history where one director has helmed both franchises.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just like, I'm thinking, how is this going to be different than the Star Trek films? Like, how is this going to transition differently into Star Wars? It's like, is it going to be different with the style, look of it? Less lens flares? I don't even know.
Well, at this point, like, I was on vacation when the trailer was released, but just after doing this podcast, we all had an opportunity to watch the trailer. And one thing I can expect is, there's jump scares, and there's soccer, because of that one droid, and... so far, the lightsaber, now they're trying to make it more like swords for some reason.
People are excited for it.
It's hands down the most anticipated film of 2015. And, like, I'm saying that, like, this is the same year where we're even going to get, like, The Avengers Age of Ultron and Kung Fu Panda 3 and Inside Out. And honestly, like, it doesn't matter. Wait, what?
This is the first time hearing of a Kung Fu Panda 3.
No, it's coming out at the same time as Star Wars. Like, late December.
Alright.
So out of all of them, Star Wars is definitely the one that people are going to go see. Like, there's going to be huge lineups for Christmas.
I'm feeling that. Mm-hmm. Age of Ultron definitely will be coming at the same time, because they're both owned by Disney. Disney's going
to... No. Here's the thing. Star Wars is going to be released on Christmas. Age of Ultron is going to be released in May, I believe?
Times of year.
Or maybe June. May or June.
Somewhere around the early summertime.
Age of Ultron is in May,
it's like the
and
first Avengers movie.
Actually, Star Wars Episode 7 is going to be released on December 18th, I believe, not on Christmas. So it's still in December, the holiday season, but we have to wait a year for it. There's a lot going on for these two franchises. I mean, they both offer two different things, yet it's set in space. At first, people were like, Force Awakening, what is this? Gotta wake up from their nap, Star Wars and the Force.
Yeah, this is that it's the Force Awakening, because if you look at the trailer, Everything sort of harkens back to the original trilogy. The designs of things, you know, not the prequel trilogy where everything was a lot more, shall I say this, seemingly more technologically advanced.
Yeah, it's true. I mean, it does, like, I feel like, funny enough, there is that feeling of the original from the color pattern, you know what I mean? Because, like, everything seems more brighter than usual.
Yeah, well, since it is a sequel series to the original trilogy, and, of course, and I think Abrams has says he's trying to go practical with most of its effects, but there's got to be some CG in there.
No, you can't, you can't get away without a few CG, especially with Disney. Like, they love using that CG.
Mm-hmm.
CG and practical effects.
A war that never ends.
That war that never ended, even though we talked about it way back.
Wasn't it one of the first episodes?
It was the first. And actually, this is one of the reasons why I did this episode, is because 2 years ago next month will be since we did a beta run of this podcast and we talked about Star Wars. Been that long.
Oh, 2 years.
2 years ago.
2 years ago.
Don't you feel old now?
Yep.
God. I don't.
You just came
in.
Oh,
welcome aboard, kiddo.
I still have my youthful glow.
So, there is a Star Trek 3 coming out in 2016 in honor of the 50th anniversary of Star Trek, which is kind of nice. I'm like, okay, they better do something freaking awesome for this anniversary. JJ is producing Star Trek 3 because he was working with Star Wars and all that shit. And one of the writers of Star Trek, I can't remember who it was. It's the guy. This guy is like, he's a writer mostly. He wrote a lot of movies that you know, and he's directing for the first time, his directorial debut. And I was like, wait a minute, you wrote films but you never directed?
Is it a good idea to have your a directorial debut be with an adaptation? Is that a good idea?
It's a little risky.
I'd say it's more than a little risky. Even if you do have J.J. Abrams producing.
Yeah. I mean, it's just...
What has this guy written?
Well, let me look him up.
Well, like...
I'm trying to remember.
Well, I mean, like, this is not, like... He's not fresh out of, like... He's not, like, fresh out where, like, this is his first movie ever that he worked on in general.
I kind of want to know what his general taste is, you know? Like, what kind of flavor can be expected? Is he into women randomly showing up in bikinis, you know? Is he into...
Oh, let's see.
Roberto Orsi.
Let's see.
Roberto Orsi.
Let's see. Oh, Jack and Jill. That's my boy, Little Nicky. Oh, we might expect Adam Sandler in Star Trek 3.
Oh, no.
I caught your tail for like half a second, and that's a half a second you won't be able to give me back.
So,
we'll just,
here we go.
We'll just see Adam Sandler popping up in the crowd scene like, you can do it!
No, that's going to be Rob Schneider.
Oh my
David
God.
Spade will be in the bikini, obviously.
Roberto Orsi, he has written The Island, The Legend of Zorro, Mission Impossible 3, Transformers, produced Eagle Eye, co-writer of Watchmen, uncredited script polish. He co-wrote and executive producer of Star Trek, co-wrote Transformers Revenge of the Fallen.
Wait,
this filmography is a wild ride, because like, I like Zorro and I like Watchmen, but the rest of it, oh no.
No. Just Mike.
He's a Michael.
No,
he's a
I don't
of Michael
think
Bay.
So.
He's a friend of Michael Bay.
I don't think this is the one. But is this the guy who's gonna go write the Dumbo reboot?
Hold on.
Is this him?
I'm looking.
It's it's got to be another Transformers writer, because it's not
Roberto. Okay, maybe, yeah. Because I remember, because
it's a Transformer writer, so I'm thinking,
yeah, because, it's the guy, he wrote, Transformers, a Scream movie, and The Ring, from under the cup.
No, but I guess he's producing the Universal Monster movie reboot.
Okay.
And Van Helsing, we talked Mummy. About.
Yeah, he's doing that, he's producing all those, so this is the same guy. He produced Now You See Me and the sequel, Now You See Me, the second act. He co-wrote The Amazing Spider-Man 2 and produced that. Producer of The Ender's Game. He co-wrote and produced People Like Us. He co-wrote and produced Cowboys and Aliens and so forth. I'm like, wait, he produced...
This is encouraging in the slightest.
It's just like, whoa, man.
He does pretty stupid schlocky action movies, doesn't he?
Yeah,
based on the television, yeah, when he produced the road stuff. So, I mean, he would be good in this field, but it's his directorial debut.
It's not Star Trek, man. It's not Star Trek. Star Trek's not supposed to be base explosion-y.
Well, here's something else.
That's Ender's Game.
Here's something else that was sort of... probably glazed over there. His first productions were Hercules and Xena back in the 90s, and
I didn't talk about TV.
And it looks like he was also executive producer on Amazing Spider-Man 2. So maybe he's not a
not Amazing Spider-Man 1.
Yet.
Oh
no, just 2.
Oh okay. Oh phew. Oh for a moment there it was. Oh, I was hoping it was the Raimi Spider-Man 2. No.
It's
he's one of many improvements made over the sequel to Amazing Spider-Man.
So, I mean, this is the guy who's going to be directing Star Trek 13. Or Star Trek 3 in this reboot
maybe
trilogy.
J.J. Abrams will come back.
If we believe hard enough and wish upon a star, J.J. Abrams will return to do Star Trek.
Why are we in a position where that's a good thing?
No.
I understand how you
feel, but he's a little preoccupied, unfortunately.
You know what this is? This is the Bryan Singer thing.
Bryan Singer.
This is when they did the third installment and they couldn't get Bryan Singer because Bryan Singer was too busy doing that other really important project. Superman Returns?
Oh, right.
The exact same thing. And you don't have both of those movies?
They both sucked?
What happened to both of those movies? Guys, this is a bad omen.
I'm not being positive with this new movie. I'm like thinking this. I mean, they better do something amazing for this 50th anniversary of Star Trek.
Well, this, I'll tell you what. When you can call it that, when you can call it that situation, when an important character from the Star Trek universe gets killed off because they have to go film with that same actor in the new Star Wars. Because that's exactly what happened with Bryan Singer.
Well, all right, here's another thing about the new trilogy of Star Wars films is that J.J. Abrams is only directing Episode 7. So after Episode 7, he's done with Star Wars. Ray Johnson, who's known for Looper, Brick, he's a very underrated sci-fi director. He's gonna write and direct the 8th one, write the 9th one, but the director is still open for the 9th
one. Does anyone know which one Brienne of Tarth is gonna be in?
Brienne of who?
Gwendolyn Christie. No? I'm the lone wolf here. Once again.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, look out for her name, because you're gonna like her character, whoever she is.
Okay, dokie.
Okay, whoever she is, Brendolyn Christie?
Gwendolyn.
Yeah.
Gwendolyn. Okay, Gwendolyn.
Yay.
Yay.
Y'all.
So.
Ignorance-driven lack of enthusiasm.
So, here's the thing. What? Which is the preferred franchise? Star Trek or Star Wars?
Well,
yeah.
For each person, it means something. But there's got to be a clear winner.
Well,
there's got to be.
No.
Like, this can't be.
No, there doesn't have to be
like,
a clear winner here.
Well,
there. Or people are like, people can like both, and people can side with one and the other, but I don't
know. You
know
what?
Maybe,
screw it. You know how we were going to sell it? Comment that crap, you guys. You tell us by commenting down below, and don't forget to subscribe.
Well, if I could... Mm-hmm.
Yeah?
Say my piece about it. To me, as someone who prefers Star Trek, it was always about the fact that Star Trek... It's about which franchise you feel has more ambition. To me, anyway. Like, you can judge them for their individual content for the quality of the piece all you want, but if they're such big franchises, then you should compare them as big franchises. Not necessarily in terms of popularity, but in terms of, like, staying power and potential. See, to me, Star Wars is always about, like, telling a good story, you know? Just telling this good story where it's good versus evil, and the evil is bad, and the good is good, and that the people who should win at the end, you know? Star Trek is always about that, you know? Who's crumpling a bag of chips or some shit? Okay, well, anyway. You know, they're about... Gene Roddenberry always had, like, this vision of wanting to show this idyllic future and wanting to show the people of his present audience what was flawed about their society, you know? That's why he always had, like, the huge diversity, even in the original show, and why that was such a big thing. Star Wars, how many female characters were in the Star Wars trilogy? One. How many non-white characters were in the Star Wars trilogy?
Oh, boy.
One! And in the prequels, it was literally the exact same thing. One female, one black guy. And the black guy was, I mean, Sam Jackson, but he didn't really do that much. He was just a member of the Jedi Council. Star Trek had a lot more diversity in its cast, you know, because it was trying to do something with that diversity. You know, it was trying to...
But that's just the humans. What about all the aliens and
wow,
stuff?
Wow, you
like
totally
that?
Noticed that, and I so didn't. Because I don't pay attention to gender or race.
Well, a lot of people do, because it's important, you know? It's really, really important, especially when you want to try and say something with your work. Like Gene Roddenberry really did. And like a lot of the people, mostly, J.J. Abrams notwithstanding, who carried on that work were trying to continue with by adding more and more to the topical statements, to the references to history, and to the episodes with really strong morals. I mean, Star Wars never traveled in time, you know? Compare the idyllic future to the present. They never went to planets that resembled something of mankind and really focused on that, you know? It was always just about defeating the Empire. Mm-hmm. Or in the prequels' case, becoming the Empire. You know, it was more focused, which in a sense is also a plus, but it was less broad. It was trying to do less. The Star Trek has always been, and I'm not sure if it's going to continue to be with the way that J.J. Abrams is trying to bring it back down to that just tell a story and make audiences happy thing. It was more ambitious. Do you get what I'm trying to say? Your comment about the aliens. Yes, there were some black people playing aliens. One of them was Jar Jar.
A black guy voiced Jar Jar Binks. Yeah.
Most of the aliens, and like the only alien I can really think of in the original, I mean, there was Chewbacca, who was played by a white person. There was Yoda, who was played by Frank Oz.
For all that stuff, you wouldn't really be able to tell because
I don't think you got what I meant, like, about the whole universe thing, because it's like, I understand of what you mean about the diversity thing, but like, that's only in the production. In terms of the world of, like, what Star Wars is, like, that's not what it's about, because, like, in terms of, like, what it is in its own universe, like, it's pretty much spread out. Like, this is, like...
It's spread out,
like,
but
it's not just... It's not just, like, the people, like, oh, they're, like, oh, in terms of humans, there's not enough, like, women, or there's not enough, like, different races. Like there... This is much more than that. Like, this is... It's not about the humans. It's about, like... Everyone else, like, all the different species of aliens and all that stuff.
But it is about the humans, because you're following the stories of the humans. And there aren't really any female aliens either, unless you count that one slave girl in front of the Jedi. That's about it. She wasn't a character.
Well, there's plenty of female characters.
Yeah, there are plenty.
They have female... Huh?
There was
Adabilia on the Jedi High Council.
Okay, you're talking expanded universe stuff with that, though. Like, in terms of characters who were important, who had names, and who wasn't important? A lot in the movies. There was pretty much just Princess Leia and then Padme. There was Anakin's mom and the decoy Amidala in the first movie. They had secondary roles, but
they're pretty big and important roles, so,
They're important to the plot, but in terms of their characters, we don't really know much about them. Because it's not important that we know much about them, it's important that they exist to get the plot going. I still don't see why
that should be such a big problem in this.
It is a huge problem not to have that kind of... the fact that Star Wars wasn't trying to make a whole lot of diversity, I mean, they are, with the new movies, they have more female roles. And
we're getting more race. We're getting more black people. They're literally jumping out of nowhere.
Yeah. Although technically, if the Jango Fett thing is true, then all Jango Fett was, I believe, Hispanic of some sort, which would mean that every clone trooper was also Hispanic in some sort. I don't know exactly what his race was. He sure wasn't white, that's for sure. But the point I'm trying to make with this is, Star Wars didn't have to worry about that kind of thing, because it wasn't trying to make a huge statement about humanity. It was just trying to tell a story and show this cool world. It was kind of really just about the human story. And yes, the stuff with representation is due to the production, but that still has an impact on the final product. You can't ignore that it does. Just because you can't necessarily get mad at it, and you can't really blame the director or the actors. You don't have to. It's what, in terms of analyzing what it all results in, and with more than just the character trying to do and say more things most of the time than Star Wars was. And that, in my opinion, is a more noble goal than just telling a open and shut story about good versus evil.
It's really distracting, like, when I hear in my voice.
What's echoing here? Who's echoing?
No, because what I'm trying to say, like, of course, Star Trek would have more to say, because, like, as it is more based on TV shows, like, they could have a lot of things to say with each episode. They wouldn't really want to focus on where they're going and stuff like that. They would focus more on the development on each of the crew members and like how they're handling the situations and stuff.
But it's also because Gene Roddenberry had a larger goal in mind when he first started creating the concept that George Lucas
didn't with Star Wars.
He wanted to make a cool sci-fi story that people liked. He didn't want to change the world.
And kind of did.
He did it in the sense of he changed pop culture. He made a big staple on pop culture, but he didn't make a lot of really revolutionary statements. You know, he didn't inspire Whoopi Goldberg to get into film. You know, he didn't cause Lucille Ball to become more successful and gain her own company and stuff like that. and to become more involved with the film. He didn't touch everybody's lives in a way that had to do with topical politics of society. It did touch their lives in the way that it was a movie that meant a lot to them, which is a different thing.
But does it does it have to be topical in order to touch the lives of people?
No, it doesn't have to be topical. It did touch their lives. It just touched their lives in a different way. And no, something doesn't have to be topical in order to be good. I'm just saying that I think it to be a more noble goal, which with a lot more staying power.
But I honestly, I get what you mean, but, like, the more neutral you could be, if it's just about all-around fun, then it could be more timeless. Because, with Star Wars, it's not trying to be too serious. It's not trying to touch on a major issue that, like, we're having with our modern society. It's just, it wants to put on a good show and just have fun with this sci-fi world. The simpler is better. And sometimes it really is, like, for something like George Lucas to make that, just something to have fun, to create a world, and it really touched the lives of people that someone can do that. It can be, like, as truly life. Life-changing and really inspirational.
In a different way. And I do understand that simpler is better, but, like, first of all, Star Trek did know how to have fun. If it didn't know how to have fun and it was just trying to save the statements without adding anything else to it, it wouldn't have succeeded. You know? It had a lot to offer while also having a lot of intelligence there, which is not to say that Star Wars wasn't intelligent. It's just that it caused you to think and also to have a good time. Like,
some of the stuff that they did in Star Trek, I believe, was what she's saying is some of the stuff that we take for granted now on television. Like, I remember people were making a big deal about Kirk kissing Uhura on the original Star Trek.
First interracial kissing on TV.
Part of the story that they actually don't tell you about that is that the networks had them to shoot it both ways. You know, they shot one version where he was just giving her a hug, and Shatner apparently was looking into the camera during that take and was making faces or something.
Of course, it's Shatner.
Because he wanted to make sure that the other take was the one that made it on television.
Yeah.
Oh, that's Shatner.
The original series, I'm going to make this the final statement of the night, possibly here. The original series did have a lot of fun, and it was simple to it, the way they were doing the show. I mean, the effects. Oh, it was the 60s, man, and... Oh, boy, compare that to Star Wars,
campy.
It's campy.
You need is a bonfire for that thing.
I still remember the one episode of the original series where they found, like, this species of alien, and it was literally just a Shih Tzu dog with a horn on his head.
Yes, I know. I was like, wait, is that a dog?
It's just a dog! It's like, with the horn.
It's so simple because they just dressed the dog. It was like, oh, that's an alien. And then the original series had that corny, you know, because it was the 60s and it had the lowball effects. But, you know, it was a good time. And the characters had, you know, each diversity, ethnicity. And you kind of like, you know what, this is like the whole world coming together to explore the space. While Star Wars is just like typical good versus bad story, which every freaking movie is pretty much all about. Of course, Star Wars kind of innovated it, sort of. Like, it was not like the first or last one. It was like kind of in the middle between those kind of movies. Eventually, when Next Generation came out, it kind of got a little more serious, but not as campy as it should be. But I guess it depends on what episode you're watching and stuff.
Yeah.
But
We've gone far from using shoe polish for our Klingons, is what he's trying to say.
Yes, they've got, I mean, it was 1987 when they came out, and it was like the mid-80s. I was like, you know what? We have better effects than we had 20 years ago, and we're going to make this gosh darn right.
When DS9 came out, which was a lot more focused on action and, like, overarching good versus evil plot, similar to Star Wars, while also keeping that broad, we're going to talk about our idealistic future sense. A lot more action-y.
So both franchises are telling their stories of sci-fi, you know, goodness, you know, whether it's diversity, topical, good versus evil. It's all good fun at the end. We're all here to be entertained by the masses, you know, trying to give us joy. And I know we're in films, but actually, I really want to see a new Star Trek series.
Please
to God, let there be a new Star Trek series. I mean, it's been 13 years since Enterprise came out.
And you don't need to bug J.J. Abrams about it. Just get television people. Huh?
Just, yeah, I mean, CBS, I think CBS has the rights to it now, so it's distribution rights.
That is true. I mean, like, if they're still making more Doctor Who's, I mean, why not another Star Trek?
Doctor Who's.
Exactly. And 2016 is the 50th anniversary. Why not, like, boom, put a series out in honor of 50 years besides Star Trek 13, the film which I'm dreading the most?
13, it's an unlucky number. Bad omens all around. And it's a good number, damn it.
Okay, that is not Star Trek or Star Wars. What the
okay,
fuck?
Okay, Firefly wins. That's the end of our argument. Firefly is the better one.
I've never seen Firefly.
Well, trust us, it's the better one.
Neither have I, but I didn't see that movie that they made. I knew.
Oh, crap, that's true. Forgot about that.
Without Star Trek, we wouldn't have Firefly.
That's true.
Josh Whedon was like, hey, Star Trek's cool. I'll make my own space western.
With blackjack and hookers. Absolutely.
Yeah!
All that good stuff.
That's kind of literally the case.
It is. Oh my god.
Yes. Futurama for the win.
Yep.
Captain's Log, 11:30:4. We have learned today that both franchises of Star Trek and Star Wars are equally as amazing to its fans, the Trekkies and the Star Wars fans.
Star Wars fans have a name?
Yes. Yeah, that's a good question. Do the Star Wars fans do the Star Wars fans have... See, that's the thing. Star Trek has Trekkies. Firefly has brown coats. What does Star Wars have?
Padawans?
What's the biggest fandoms in the world? How do they not have a fandom name?
Padawans?
Yeah, there you go. Star Trek Jedi's. Wins.
Jedi Knights.
Jedi's.
Yeah, Padawans sounds...
Hope that's as legit as brown coats.
Yeah, it does. So, next month is going to be like a retrospective month, but I didn't reveal anything to you guys, so I'm going to list off some movies, and I'm going to say, what do they have in common?
Well, I love guessing games.
We always do that at the end, so...
So I'm going to list some films, and I want you to think about what they have in common.
They all have Kevin Bacon in them. Did I win?
They all have bacon in them.
Bacon. Bacon's good. Let's see. Spider-Man 2. Shrek 2. The Incredibles. Passion of the Christ. Day After Tomorrow. Troy. Shark Tale. Meet the
Bonkers. I know. Okay, I got it.
Ocean's 12.
They all have numbers in them. No.
Nope. They were all released in 2004.
Yep. 10 years ago.
Exactly. We were just talking about the year 2000.
Exactly.
What is this insanity?
I was laughing when you guys were talking about
because it's like,
I was like,
because it's like you were mentioning, it was like, I thought it was sequels, it was like Spider-Man 2, and then Shrek 2, and then and then you mentioned The Incredibles, and then Shark Tale, it was like, oh, 2004!
I know you guys were talking about it, I was like, wait, that's what I was saying, wait.
So we're having a month over the year 2004?
The second episode in December will be a different year.
Oh, okay. That's cool.
Wait, what? I don't get it. Wait. So,
next episode, we're going to take a look at films from 10 years ago exactly in 2004. See how much we changed in 10 years. See what kind of films we made since 2004.
That was interesting.
It'll take some thinking.
I mean, you think about it. Yeah. I mean, there's animated movies. There's all kinds of stuff. And
more.
All that stuff.
Okay.
The second episode next month, I will talk about that some other time because that's scheduling influence. But this has been Cinema Royale.
Wait a minute, before we leave, I want to ask everyone a question. I want to know what the pirate said upon his 80th birthday. You know? Aye, matey.
Goodbye, everybody. Make sure you subscribe and comment below which is your favorite, Star Trek or Star Wars. We'll see you in 2 weeks with films of 2004.
Ciao for now, y'all.
The cast of Cinema Royale would like to apologize to all 80-year-old pirates for that pun. We do not meant to offend anybody with that thing, so...
God, it's not cloudy too.
Oh jeez. No, Mike, don't bring that up again.
Run, Mike, run! Cloudy 2 has much better puns. Oh, I forgot Dino S'more. That was in the credits of Cloudy with a Chance of Meatballs 2, the Dino S'more. He's a dinosaur s'more.
Oh.
I won't agree with anything you have to say. You don't appreciate puns as a form of art. That in
it's
itself
is not an art.
You know what? Any poet, teacher will tell you that there is an art to wordplay. You know? Even if it's corny, it's still a wordplay. And it's still a fun time. That's right. I just brought an education into this. What are you gonna do?
Hi, guys.
I'm taking that to mean I won.
What? Nobody wins.
I didn't hear anything.
Oh, yeah. Anyways.
We also realized that Cloudy 2 is an underrated master.
Yes, that is exactly what we realized. Right? Do I have to bring out the keyblade? There's a leak in the boat! Ah! Comedy gold.
She must really have a field day when watching Food Fight as well.
That's crossing a line. You just crossed the line, Matt.
Oopsie!
We joke around, but there are limits.
There's only one thing to say. Oopsie!
No.
That wasn't even really in the second movie as much as it was in the first one. That was just
one
stupid little joke. That does not judge the quality of the entire movie.
It does.
It does not in the slightest.
Oh,
I have friends when she died. Would argue with that statement.
with that information, Kirk out.
Yeah, I'm getting freaking tired. I've
see you guys in 2 weeks. Yeah. Find two films from 2004.
I already got one. I already got one reserved.
Dibs
so.
On SpongeBob. Dibs on SpongeBob.
No, damn it! I want a SpongeBob. Come on! I want a SpongeBob.
I grew up on the show. Dibs on
I grew up on the show as well.
I grew up on the show too. Dibs on
Are you sure?
Yes.
I was 9 when it came out.
Dibs.
Yeah, I want SpongeBob movie.
I was 8 when the movie came out, and I saw it in theaters.
I saw it in theaters as well.
I got dibs.
I saw it in theaters
too.
Yeah,
well, you didn't get dibs. I got dibs. SpongeBob, it's mine.
New developing results here on the podcast. Dibs is a thing.
Yeah,
now.
Really, is it?
SpongeBob is mine. Oh, I've got a second one too. I don't know if you all will think of it, but
I got my 2 films already, so. Think about it. 2 weeks. Cook
all
it.
Right.
2 films that aren't SpongeBob. Have fun.
Have fun with that.
We will.
Adios.